didn't like that.
What we'd like to demonstrate here this afternoon is how to row better on an ergo. A few tips that will make you go faster on the ergo, give you a better rowing stroke, and give you better times. The first thing that's really important for every athlete to understand is that when you're rowing on the erg, it's important to make sure that you've got loose shoulders and you've got your core turned on low down. Now, the easiest way to demonstrate this I've found with athletes is with a broomstick. So you get a piece of broomstick handle like so, and sit in this position. Now, what I'm going to do, firstly, I'll turn my shoulders on, and so I'll grab at it, and then Lachlan's going to try and pull me over, and so I'm going to pull on the broom handle, and we'll see what happens. So, ready? Oops! Ooh, it's dangerous. So, as you can see, it's quite easy for you to lift me up. Now, if instead, change nothing at all, but I'll turn on my lower core right down here, and leave my shoulders really loose, so I'm in that position now, so now try and pull me over without breaking me.
It's at least twice the power.
It's a lot harder. As Lachlan says, it takes twice as much effort to try and pull me up. What that demonstrates to an athlete very clearly is if you have an athlete in my position and then you swap over and have an athlete in Lachlan's position, then they'll get to understand quite well what it is that's required in order to get a good connection and have the body in the right position. So it's all about turning his lower core on, driving with the legs with loose shoulders. If they have tense shoulders and grabbing up with their upper body, then you'll find they get less power. So now let's watch it on an erg. So translating that exercise onto the ergo, it's important again, turn the lower core on right down here and leave all of the upper body quite relaxed. So if you just grab the handle. Now, what we're looking to do is, the thing that we're really trying to avoid is lifting with the shoulders. So if you just demonstrate lifting with the shoulders, that's definitely what we're trying to avoid. The way to do it is to have all the shoulders relaxed, really loose grip. Very important. It's impossible to have relaxed shoulders if you've got a tight grip. So really relaxed grip, and then turn on the lower core muscles. So turn on these muscle group down here, really tight, leave all this really relaxed. And all it is just, with the lower core on, is just push. So if you just push, Lachlan. Really relaxed shoulders, just push. Better. Okay. Now, the way to demonstrate this, so that you get a good handle on the technique, is the same sort of deal as we were doing with the broomstick. If I hang onto the handle, and I ask Lachlan to relax everything up the top, and to just push with his lower body, he should feel himself start to sort of come off the seat a fraction, but not very much. So he'll feel a little bit lighter on the seat. Now, if he's rowing well in this regard, what happens to the weight on the seat is he doesn't come off the seat so much, but he has less weight. He can feel less weight on the seat, but enough for him to carry enough for him to stay connected with the seat. The sensation for the athlete should be that they turn this lower core on and they feel a slight lightening on the seat of their body as they go through the rowing stroke, and then they're back on the seat when they get to the finish. So if you can imagine, they're sitting on the seat with full weight now, do the leg drive. If they've got the core turned on and they're driving hard, then it'll feel a bit lighter on the seat, and then they'll sit back on the seat heavily at the end. A really useful technique to help the athletes understand the concept of getting the lower core on and getting a lot of drive into the ergo, i.e. get the legs on. As soon as the legs are on, then really open up with your lower core, not your shoulders. So it's really about getting the power of your these huge muscles through here into play and getting them to work against the legs to try and really drive that ergo. A useful technique for demonstrating it on the ergo is to hang onto the seat, and when the athlete's under power, move the seat. Now, I suggest, unless you want them to yell at you, that you tell them what you're going to do, because it's a pretty disconcerting feeling. So let's demonstrate here this movement, this hanging onto the seat. What we're demonstrating is that as the athlete gets their legs on, they get their lower core on, they've really got that power going, they're going to become lighter on the seat during that phase of the stroke and then back onto the seat at the finish. So they're on the seat at the front, they get the power on, they lift slightly off the seat, and then they sit down again. If they're not under power there, and if you can't move the seat a little bit when they're in that middle phase, then they're not doing it correctly and they haven't got the maximum power they can get. So the way to make an ergo go fast and with care is like this. just hang onto the seat, just gently. And when he's going, it's just moving a bit. I'm just giving it a little tug in the middle bit of the strike wheel. So, from Lachlan's perspective, how did that feel?
A bit disconcerting, yeah.
And so you could feel the seat moving a little bit?
Yeah, you can feel. You can definitely feel when you've got your weight on the seat and when it's just a little bit off.
Yeah.
It's a completely different feel.
Yeah. If you come off the seat a long way, then that probably means you're using your shoulders. If you go back to the broomstick example, so you're using your shoulders and you haven't got the maximum power. But if you've got the lower core turned on and you've got that power on, then you know you've got a lot of power if you're pulling on the seat. Just a word for those who are going to hang onto the seat is you really only need to move it about that far at the most. If you move it much further than that, you run the risk of ending up with the athlete sitting on the bar, and that won't make you popular.
Yeah, it could quite easily have pulled it out from underneath me. Like that's, yeah, you have to be careful.
Yeah, it is easy to pull it out because there is almost no weight on that seat at that point. So it's very easy to pull it out. So what I suggest you do is pull it out a little bit, and then the athlete will sort of wriggle it back into the right place by the next couple of strokes, and then just do it again, just to reinforce that. The concept is get the legs on powerful, get the lower core really turned on, get the back right into it, and you'll find you get that little bit of lightness on the seat, and you'll know you've got some power happening. If your body doesn't come off the seat at all, so it doesn't feel light on the seat, then essentially you're not applying as much power as you can. So the next thing we want to demonstrate is which part of the body we should turn on when we're driving. So if you come forward, Lachlan. Now, what we're looking for is we're trying to avoid lifting of the shoulders. So if you just lift with the shoulders without doing a full stroke, just lift your shoulders. So that's really what we don't want. By the same token, we don't want to find that they're shooting the slide so that their bum just goes out and their shoulders fall over. So if you want to shoot the slide for me, like that. We want to avoid that. The combination is to sit, come forward, is to sit here and turn this quad really strong so it's connected, so there's no shooting of the slide, no lifting of the shoulders. But then what we want to do is, as soon as we're connected at the catch, we want to then start to open up with our lower core. So we want to essentially start to uncurl. So what that means is that when we're connected, we've got the leg drive on hard, if you try and get the body to open up against the legs relatively early in the stroke. Now you'll find that this makes you go a lot faster. Very significant difference. The thing to watch, when it's the first time you do it, first time I've done this with most athletes, is that they tire very quickly and start to lose posture, particularly in their lower back and in their core. And that's simply that they don't have a strong enough core to be able to handle that technique. In which case, see a physio, get some exercises, work hard on your core and make sure that you build that strength up so that you can do it in a sustained fashion. If you find that when you're on the ergo you can only do it for say 10 strokes without starting to lose your posture, then I suggest stop until you've got a stronger core, because otherwise you're just going to be reinforcing a bad habit. But if you can get your rowing stroke so that you get connected at the catch, and then as soon as your leg drive's underway you start to open up from your lower body and uncurl and really put your back into it and push your back against your legs, then you'll find you get a much more powerful stroke and you'll get much better scores. Very important part of the rowing stroke to get that right if you're trying for maximum scores. The issue in having beginners row like that is that they tend to misinterpret that, and instead of opening up with their core down here, they actually open up with their shoulders. And so I think it's easier to demonstrate rowing where you get connected with your feet and then you have your leg drive and then you open up, get that bit understood well before you start to move to this more advanced area where you say, right, I'm going to start to open up as soon as I'm connected. So a very good way to improve your speed on the ergo.
Okay.
Another absolutely critical part of rowing well on an ergo is picking the catch correctly. It's really important you grab that flywheel right at the front. If you start to move down the slide a bit before you get the flywheel caught, then you're just missing the opportunity and you're missing the catch. So you want to grab it right at the front. You've got to really pick it up well. Now, often you'll see athletes that come out of the front slowly, like that. So if you look what's happening here, you can see that I'm missing about 2 inches with the chain before I've actually caught the flywheel. If you listen really carefully, and perhaps a bit hard on this video, you can hear it. You can hear the slide moving, and you can hear when it picks up the wheel, the flywheel. So if you listen to it really carefully, you'll be able to see the moment at which I pick up the flywheel, and you'll be able to hear the difference in the slide. Very important, very important. Hard to get right. What you need to be able to do is you need to be able to pick up that flywheel right at the beginning. Now, the technique to do it is to come into the catch with one foot in only, gives you better control, and just sitting here relaxed, and just trying to pick that first bit. That's better. And so when I do that, I can feel, as soon as I use my leg, I can feel that I've got the catch. You can feel the flywheel. Do the same with the other foot, just so you get comfortable with the concept. And it's about just making sure that you've got that first bit. And I'm not saying doing this, because that's really counter what we're trying to do. We don't want to use our upper body. It's all about taking the catch with your feet. And once you've got it understood like that, then do it with both feet together. Again, it's coming to the front, and instead of coming in like that to take the catch, you want to come in and you've got to get right onto it. It's got to be quick. Some athletes will find the way to fix that is simply to plant their heels. So if you get here and you just put your heels down, then that helps you to get that sensation. Whereas if you start to push, then you'll find that you miss that first bit. And so here I am again, I'm missing the first bit. I can feel that I haven't got that connection until I'm about 3 inches into the rowing stroke. Whereas if I come into the front and I get that first bit, takes a bit of practice, then you'll find that you can get it by putting your heels down. May well be the easiest way to get it. But as I say, the easiest way to practice it is one leg in and just trying to get that first bit. I'd have to say I'm not perfect at it, I've seen better, but that's the technique. If you can do that, then you're going to get a much more powerful stroke. Remember though, very important, you think you can do it like that, but it doesn't work. One thing you'll find with some athletes, once they get used to that concept, and they have really loose arms, and they've taken the catch with their feet, I've actually had it said to me that by an athlete a few times that I don't have a catch anymore, because they're used to feeling this sort of a sensation with their upper body and grabbing at it. And when they start to take the stroke properly, loose arms, relaxed shoulders, and they're taking it just with their feet and just getting that quick connection, then you'll find that the catch feels different. I actually had one athlete that said to me about a week later, I still don't have a catch, but I'm going faster. And that's really what it's about, is relaxed, loose, and just be able to pick that catch. So a good technique, one foot in, then the other, and then together. But remember, that first bit of the stroke is really important. The more you watch for it, the more you'll see it. So it's worth educating your eye, so when athletes are rowing on the ergo, that you can tell if they're missing that first part of the catch. So Lachlan, do you want to have a demonstration on that? I'd have the athlete row and ask them to watch the chain in here as they take the catch, and in their mind, think about when they're actually getting their legs underway, when they're starting to move down the slide. So do a few strokes and monitor what's happening at the front. How far that chain moves before you feel the weight of the loose shoulders. You see here there's a small difference there where the chain's moved and we haven't really got connected. So if we stop that now, and if we just go to this exercise with one foot in, one foot out, and you'll find it's easier to do it. I'll put the other foot on the ground, so you're just supporting yourself. It's really just, it's a comfortable position, and you just want to be able to take that first bit really relaxed up here. And you want to feel as soon as you plant your heels, so come forward a bit more so your heels come up. As soon as you plant your heels, you want to know you're connected immediately. That's better. Feel the difference on that one?
Yeah.
Much different. And so I do it for a while on one leg, then do the other leg. Again, we're just trying to get up to the front. Easiest way probably is just plant your heels quickly. and you want to feel that you've got the flywheel straight away. Otherwise, you're just missing that catch. So now try it with both. It's the same process though, yeah, just that front bit. You want to make sure you've got the flywheel every time. If you concentrate on that, and then if you combine that together with, once you've got that connection, you've got your lower core turned on, you really get the body into it, so you're light on the seat, then you'll find that you're getting the maximum you can out of the ergo from the catch perspective.
Yeah, so I felt like, yeah, like I thought I used to get my legs on quickly at the catch, but I really felt the difference when I pushed my heels down to start with, just to start that first little bit. Like I felt like it was no
connect.
Lag,
yeah.
Whereas it feels a lot more smooth when you put them down slowly, but it's not as connected.
Connection's so important. So on the ergo, you want to make the ergo go fast in this part of the stroke, is practice that technique to make sure that you get connection to the flywheel immediately. If you're not connected to the flywheel and you're moving down the seat, then you're wasting it. So we want to get connected immediately, and the best way to practice it is with that little drill like that. And I'd suggest for quite a while with athletes, when they're trying to get this better, is that before they start out on the ergo, once they've done their warm-up, is I suggest that they do a drill like that, both legs, one at a time, then together, and practice that connection so when they do get into their proper ergo session, they've got good connection right from the beginning.
It's the heels down,
If you had a...
Because it forces you to put the weight straight into the foot structure if you put the heels down.
Yeah. And it's...
And you don't... It's almost like pre-tensioning, so once you get... If you put the heels down, then you're connected and push, whereas if you push, you have to take up all the tension in your Achilles.
Yeah. And just on.
Yeah, because you don't actually, by pushing the heels down, you don't actually move until you connect.
Yeah.
Whereas when you push the heels down slowly, you move slowly.
And that's what happens. You start to move and you just
have to take up the slack in your legs first.
Yeah, and you haven't got connection to the flywheel, so it's important to get that dynamic, quick catch to get that connected. The other thing you can do, if you happen to have a Rowing in Motion app on your phone, then and you have an ergo on sliders, and I've done this before and it's an interesting outcome, and you put the Rowing in Motion app on here, so put the phone on here. What the Rowing in Motion app does, it shows a trace of the acceleration in the boat. Now on an ergo it's quite a different pattern, of course, because it's not a boat, but what it does do is that if you're rowing and you're missing that connection at the catch, you'll see that the trace goes along flat for a minute and then it goes up. And it does that, and then as soon as you start to get it right, it doesn't do this flat bit and go up, it just goes straight up. And so if you happen to have that app on your phone, I'd suggest stick it on the ergo with the ergo on sliders, very important it's on sliders, and just watch that trace. Now the beauty of having it there is that the athlete can actually see the trace. And so the easy way to do it is to get them to row normally and you'll see this flat bit and then it goes up in speed. And so then once they've got that in pattern, then say, now get rid of that flat bit for me. And it'll take them about two strokes, I reckon, and they'll get rid of it. And they'll suddenly understand what we're about. So it's another useful tool that you can use to demonstrate that getting connected at the catch. And because it's a visual outline of the stroke, then the athlete can see that and they can change it in real time. So they see one stroke that goes like that, and then the next stroke they change something and they can see the difference immediately. Very good way of demonstrating and changing an athlete's behavior to get that connection. Very important to get that connection.
Can you use the graph on the Concept 2 at all?
Unfortunately, no. The graph on the Concept 2 doesn't, it's only about power on the ergo, so it's not related to the movement of the ergo.
Yeah.
So it's only about the flywheel. So if we're not connected to the flywheel, then the graph's not going to start. So that doesn't really tell us.
When you put the power on.
Yeah.
And that's not registering that loss at the start.
That's right. But if you put a Rowing in Motion, or pretty much any accelerometer would do, but that's the particular app that I use, and the Rowing in Motion on there, then you can see it. It goes flat and it goes up, flat and it goes up. And you say, fix that. And you'll find an athlete will find in about two strokes how to get rid of that. And it's essentially by doing what we just did then. But holding that, of course, takes practice, but really good technique to make sure you get better times on the ergo. We've talked a fair bit about the importance of getting the catch right, getting the connection with the flywheel immediate, getting the lower core turned on, driving hard with the legs, lifting yourself, making yourself light on the seat with that power, not with the shoulders. One of the things to do that properly is that as you're coming into the catch, you want to give yourself time to think about it. You want to have time coming into the catch so that you're ready, your body's in the right position, you've got nice and relaxed arms, you're ready for the catch, you know what you're going to do when you get to the catch, and you know you're going to pick that flywheel up just like that. The way to do that is to make sure you come down the slide slow. So when you're rowing, it's important to make sure that when you're coming down to the front, you give yourself plenty of time coming into the catch and don't come into the catch hard. If you come into the catch fast, then you'll find that you won't go faster. But firstly, the main reason why it's a problem is because when you come into the catch hard, then you haven't got time to get those things right. And what you really want to do is you get the ergo, the flywheel, going fast with the power stroke, and then you want to let it keep going whilst you recover coming down the slide. So you want to recover. So if we just demonstrate here, Lachlan, just rowing normally, I want to make sure when you, say, you just take a stroke and then off the back, hands away, body over, in the right position and gently into the front. It's important to come into the front nice and relaxed. In fact, it's better to, when you get to the finish, to get out of the finish reasonably quickly and then give yourself more time coming into the slide. Because you want to get the maximum power in the stroke and then back over your feet in the right position, give yourself time coming into the front. Now, if you're in a rowing boat, you want to do it for slightly different reasons. But on the ergo, the same thing applies. You want to give yourself a recovery time so that your body does recover a little, and to make sure when you come into the front, you're ready for it. So you know what you're going to do in order to pick up that flywheel. You've got your core turned on, solid, ready for it. You know you're going to uncurl from down here, and so you can get a powerful stroke every time. So important to allow yourself some recovery time. So I suggest if you take that series of tips we've got there, then you'll find that you'll be able to go much faster on the ergo, get much better times, and get a better experience out of the rowing, pretty much because you're rowing better. But the important things to remember, particularly important things, is pick up the flywheel immediately. Don't hesitate, don't let it drift. Grab the flywheel immediately and make sure that you're doing it with your feet, not your upper body, and then turn your core on and drive, as you come to the front, turn your core on and then drive hard through that first part of the drive phase so your legs are on hard and your body's working hard against your legs in order to maximize the power you can get. You'll find if you do that with a relaxed upper body that your arms will pretty much take care of themselves. And of course there's power in the arms as well, and so use them all. The other thing is that you'll find some people are more powerful in different parts of the body, and so you'll find that people apply these techniques a little differently, but the fundamentals are still the same. So practice them, work on them, and you'll get better scores. Another part of our core is turned on, and we make sure that...
Sorry,